This is a production of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America.
Busyness isn't next to godliness, but if it's the spiritual gift that's busy, it is truly godlike.
We try to look at how we can best bring our families together and serve families together instead of pulling them apart.
I think the answer is for folks to look seriously at what their anxieties are, what their angers are, what things frustrate them, and for them to start to make hard choices about what's really important.
Hello and welcome to Mosaic, the video magazine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. I'm your host, Melissa Ramirez. Thanks for watching. We're in the Time Exhibit, part of Chicago's famed Museum of Science and Industry. Here, more than 500 clocks, from quadrants to simple sundials and atomic clocks, are on display. The exhibit shows how humans have struggled to keep time on track. These days, Americans are taking time to determine what's important. Faith, family, and prayer have taken on a new emphasis. This issue of Mosaic is dedicated to busy families. Most Americans agree it's difficult to take time for family. With jobs, schools, sports, worship services, and other activities, many families in the church are caught in a juggling act. In this story, we'll meet with three Lutheran families who've learned how to juggle pretty well.
Mike Becker and Corey Reed Becker are what you might call a traditional suburban family. Almost. Married with three young children, Mike and Corey are faithful members of Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Naperville, Illinois. Corey teaches Sunday school. Mike serves on the congregation's preschool advisory board. While Mike sings in the 11 o'clock worship service, Corey and the kids sing along with the congregation. What sets Mike and Corey apart is their professional lives. Monday through Friday, it's Corey, not Mike, that jumps on a commuter train and heads downtown for a corporate communication job with Quaker Oats. While Corey is downtown, Mike stays home, cooks, cleans, and sees the kids off to school. This dad is high tech and organized. Using computers and cell phones like any business manager, Mike and the kids plow through their day with gusto.
Kids in Madison and Austin, come on, breakfast is ready.
They all do the same thing.
You want more? Okay, well show me you're gonna eat some of it first. How about you guys split an orange? You gonna have some orange, Maddie? You're just not gonna eat today, are you? Okay, no snacks. Do you wanna go to the park? You gotta brush your teeth first.
You have to have some kind of fruit juice snack of some sort. And then, of course, the fish crackers are always a bonus. You always have to have a good supply of diapers, because you never know with Austin what's going to happen.
Boom, boom, cha, cha, cha.
The wipes, of course, but those aren't just for him. Those are for the kids if they eat a snack or get all sandy or whatever.
Okay, how about after I do this, you try to go potty for me?
No.
We like to have the sun hats in there just in case we get a little sunny and they like to put something on. And we have the change of clothes in here just in case we have an accident.
Go away, doggy! Choo-choo!
Use words to talk to Austin, honey.
And the changing pad and the coloring books and the crayons and so forth.
Austin's gonna bite me!
Just in case we're waiting somewhere. Those are just packed in there just in case we need them sometimes.
Thank you!
You're welcome.
Of course, we have the sippy cups with water for the trip to the park because they're gonna run around and sweat. And then in the front part, we have a little bit of everything. We have sunscreen and sunglasses and...
Oh!
Okay, come sit down, Daddy. Put shoes on.
Desitin and a bib and...
Can you go turn lights off for me, please?
No.
All kinds of stuff that we might need for the day. Hey, Jay, you gonna turn lights off for Daddy?
Sure.
I got three bosses that let me know on a daily basis whether or not I'm doing a good job. Evidently, one of my bosses right now isn't very happy with me. And then they can give me some really great positive feedback. They come over and give me a hug if I'm not having that great a day or something.
And of course, it's easier for me to tease him and say, okay, you've got the best job. I don't get hugs at work where I come from. But we have a lot of fun. There are times where it's tense. And when we started this whole venture with Mike staying home and me working, it was just really an experiment for a while.
Corey and I have made the commitment with us staying home that we were going to try to keep our kids as involved as we could. That's not going to kill our schedule and it's not going to totally wear them out. Where we've made our sacrifices is for our kids. Kedzie's probably involved in the most. She's got kindergarten. She's got dance class, swimming, kinder music, gymnastics. Maddie's got preschool, kinder music, dance, swimming, and a form of gymnastics. And then, of course, Austin, he's not involved in too much yet. He's just got swimming and kinder music. And oh, he's got a gym class, too.
Fitting a busy family, Mike and Corey are members of a busy congregation. Gary Olson and Greg Wenhold are senior pastors at Good Shepherd.
We have a lot of busy families here at this place. In fact, the average or the median age of this congregation is 26.5. We've got people that are really engaged in busy activities. Mike's a stay-at-home dad. Corey goes into downtown Chicago every day, and yet they manage their three little children in a wonderful Christian environment. And they just seem like one example of a little bit different lifestyle that is really integrating their Christian faith with their busyness of their lives.
His whole life has begun to pop, not only as a dad who cares for his family, but also what he does around this church. He's highly active in our preschool, and there's a playground which is being constructed, and Mike has been right at the center of that. So he'll come on over with his kids, and they'll be pushing the stroller down through the narthex, and people have gotten to know Mike and the three children very well.
Rather than add to Mike and Corey's already busy lives, Wenhold and Olson feel that by accurately identifying and then using their gifts, both the family and the congregation benefit.
One of the things we've done here at Good Shepherd has been to really be intentional about discerning what people's spiritual gifts are. We do not want to just plug ministry gaps by saying we need a third grade teacher, so guess what, you're it. We intend to discover what the spiritual gifts are with the people. We go through processes to do that.
When people are too busy, we run the risk that their spiritual gift is not what emanates from who they are. What ends up happening is a task gets done. Mm-hmm. We create, to the best of our ability, with God guiding us, a place where people don't have to feel as if they're just connecting for the sake of being busy, but connecting because they're using what God breathed into them to the best of their ability. And so busyness isn't next to godliness, but if it's the spiritual gift that's busy, it is truly godlike.
Having kids initially is what made us go back to church. We had both been raised in church environments younger, and then when we got married with our busy lives, we had probably walked away for a while, and then having children made us come back and realize that, you know, the important things, I guess, in life that you talk about.
Aurora, Illinois lies several miles to the west of the Beckers' home in Naperville. The city of 143,000 people is 32% Latino. Pedro Suarez and his wife Aura have two children, Rafael and Melinda, in this river town. Pedro is the pastor of San Francisco Lutheran Church. Aura is a social worker. One way to spend time with your family without adding to busyness is to share common interests. For the Suarez family, that means music.
For me, the way that I release all my stress is with music. Sometimes I'm really, really, really stressed out, and then I pick up my guitar, start picking it and playing it. And they see that, and they want to follow that too. And then we just get together and jam and play.
Like anyone else, it's a challenge for pastors to make time for family.
Sometimes we can't all have dinner. Sometimes I'm not there, sometimes my dad's not there, sometimes Molly's not there, sometimes my mom's not there, and we can't all eat together. And that's just something we have to go through because we're always so busy.
Sometimes I will wish that we could have more time together, you know, as a family. You know, especially now that Rafi is almost getting out of school and he's pretty soon he's going to leave home. We have to make more time. I think that's something that we have to have as a goal. Because sometimes it's like, you know, a lot of people and people and people and doing things with other people. And, you know, it's good, but at the same time, we have to have more time.
Since they were babies, we have sang to them, play guitars, and they've seen me with so many guitars. Lately, I picked up the trumpet. Rafi has been playing the trumpet for a while. He had to drop band because he wants some more art, and he didn't have the choice. It was hard for him to do, and I say, I can't have him just lose trumpet that easy. So if I can encourage him, so I picked up my trumpet too.
Melinda,
wow. She was a little kid.
Yeah,
she studied piano for several years. Mm-hmm. Then she started percussion at school. I taught her some basics on the drum sets and got her the drum set, got her excited about it. And then when she started noticing that she could carry a beat, and whoa, here we go. And then I remember just only about 2 weeks after she was been playing, I said, I want to play in church.
In a large house on the south side of Minneapolis, the Hansen family sits down to dinner. The Hansens use the dinner table in the same way the Suarez family uses music to bring them together.
In spite of our busyness, we work very hard to tend to our relationships with one another. Now, for Ione, who is the director of social work at the two children's hospitals in the Twin Cities, supervises 85 social workers. Though she doesn't get the media attention, she has perhaps a more stressful call than I do. It's meant on the one hand just sharing the logistical work of co-parenting. We divide cooking and laundry and grocery shopping and cleaning. Our children try to pitch in on those tasks, although I think they've had it pretty easy. But most important in our family has been the evening meal, where at least one of us as a parent has been present, at least two or three of our six children at the table, for table prayer, for checking in, for laughter, sometimes silence. I think our family has prepared me to be presiding bishop perhaps more than any other experience, to respect diversity, to be reminded that even as a talker, I need to listen, to ground relationships at the table, for me as bishop, at the table of Christ's presence in the Eucharist, but also through this church at the many tables at which people gather, that they don't always find agreement, but they find commonality in faith and commitment to be witnesses to God's grace, and to tend to the work that goes involved in bringing people together at a table.
It's time to introduce the ELCA's new presiding bishop, the Reverend Mark Hansen, to your congregation. Mosaic has produced a new video on his life and ministry. Take a minute and give us a call today at 1-800-638-3522, extension 6009, or log on to our website for a copy today. How do congregations really help busy families? Do their programs actually add to a family's already busy schedule? Bethel Lutheran Church in Rochester, Minnesota is finding ways to help its members balance their hectic lives while still being committed to their congregation.
ELCA congregations are busy places. Whether it's a Friday night Native Alaskan hymn sing on the Seward Peninsula or a Saturday morning youth servant event at Angelica Lutheran Church in Los Angeles or a midweek after-school program in Saginaw, Michigan, ELCA congregations are no longer Sunday-only ministries. Many congregations have programs going 7 days a week, eight if you talk to some pastors. Try this experiment. On paper, list all the ministries your congregation is involved in. Then, list congregational members serving on more than one committee or program. Then ask yourself the question, are we burning people out? How family-friendly are you? It's another Saturday morning at Bethel Lutheran Church in Rochester, Minnesota. Pastor Julie Rognes and Bethel staff member Jeanette Knock are hosting an orientation for preschoolers and their parents. Part of Bethel's annual Rally Day festivities, the event is only a small part of a busy weekend.
You are beginning now that instructed in the Christian faith step of the promises you made at the time your children were baptized.
After the orientation, it's over to the sanctuary where Julie puts on robes and performs a wedding. Before the rice is tossed, she's out the back door and on the way to son Nathan's football game. Nathan caught a ride to the game with his dad, who was on the way to the airport for a business trip to Tennessee.
Make sure you win, Nathan.
I will.
What gives me balance in my life is not trying to accomplish everything, is to pick those things that maybe I feel are most important for myself and for my children.
Julie makes it just in time to console Nathan after a tough loss.
It's too busy right now. Yep, it feels like fall. I've joked that we could maybe skip September and October and just go right into November.
Congregation, do you promise to support and encourage these parents?
Like a lot of congregations, Bethel and their staff are busy, but they call it a healthy kind of busy that knits families together. Jeanette Knock is Bethel's director of family ministry.
We try to look at everything through the lens of the family. And how we can best bring our families together and serve families together instead of pulling them apart. I think the church has done that unwittingly. I don't think the church says, let's try to pull the family apart. But when they walk in the door, if they all go different ways, that's not what we want to do. So if we can get them all together in the same place, working on the same things together, learning the same things, playing together, great, serving together. That's what we want to be about.
Welcome to Mosaic. It's great to have you here.
One way Bethel is bringing young families together is by turning their basement fellowship hall into a new, family-oriented worship service they call Mosaic.
Mosaic worship is an alternative opportunity for families to worship around tables and be a little more flexible in how their children might behave here so that they have a chance to run and get a drink of water or play with their trucks at the table or even bring a cookie down to worship. So they feel welcomed in and included. The pieces of the worship are very Lutheran and includes the reading of the scriptures for the day. We follow the regular lectionary. We also do the creed and confession. On communion Sundays, there's communion that's offered down here. Offering is taken.
Peter and Tammy Wold have been bringing their children to the Mosaic service since Bethel began offering it as an alternative.
It's been a nice option because it gives us a chance to have a good hour together every Sunday. The group here is just a lot of fun. Everyone else that participates in the family ministry is basically in the same boat we are, young parents with young kids. Our little guy over there, Harrison's a pretty busy guy, and the informal setting of family ministry makes it a lot more stress-free, a lot more fun for everybody, I think.
They encourage him to get down and play with his cars or run around. They don't mind if that happens, so it's kind of nice.
Those who like it a lot, and they're back here for the second year.
Many families feel meeting to death. Often church council is one night and choir rehearsal another. One way Bethel is trying to help busy families is by combining meetings on one or two nights and providing child care.
The family ministry team, the adult education team, and the Christian education team all meet the same night, one after another. We have child care available when we have team meetings that there would be parents that would have to secure child care to be able to be here. My family ministry team meets in the nursery, so the kids can be there with the parents. Sometimes the kids are just a great resource, you know. Would you like to do this? Yeah, Mommy, yeah, let's do that. There isn't one kind of family today. There are lots of different kinds of families. There are families that are the traditional two parents, 2-point-whatever kids. There are lots of single-parent families. There are single people that have adopted. We have some grandparents that are raising grandkids. There are all sorts of different kinds of families in our congregation and community. If your family is centered on faith and on being faithful people, being centered in Christ, then that's how you make your decisions, how you're going to spend your time, what you're going to do as family activities. What are you doing on Sunday morning? Even if you aren't at church on a Sunday morning, is what you're doing somehow going to be a faith experience for your family, for your kids, for your relationship?
In business, time is money. Applied to the church, time can be translated into ministry. Solomon puts it this way: there is a time to every purpose under heaven. In this story, Mosaic talks with experts in the field of family ministries as they share their ideas about ways your congregation can help busy families make the most out of their time at the congregational level and in daily life.
Mim Campbell works with Children and Family Ministry in the ELCA's Division for Congregational Ministry. A single parent, Mim knows firsthand the challenges facing busy families today.
The ELCA is having more and more to say about busy families as we're realizing the busyness of our own and the reality of the challenges in it and the priorities and the choices that we each make on our own and wondering where God is in the midst of that, in the midst of traffic on the way to and from places, in the midst of conversations with our own teenagers, or in the questions that our young children have of what's going on in the world on any given day. As we grow in honesty about our need for faith and Christ in our own homes, we can't help but wonder, where is Christ in the midst of other homes, and what are we doing to make faith really relevant? We need to rethink the way that we're doing congregational ministry. We've been program-based for a long time, and we've had many opportunities for people to become involved in doing things as they're growing together. With the many tasks that we are already involved in life, church tasks can become just another thing to do. I think that many people today think of church as another organization to belong to, with its own list of things to do and tasks to accomplish and expectations that they're going to need to fulfill. We may be guilty of giving people that impression in the midst of the many programs that we present and in the midst of the many tasks that there are to do in an ongoing faith community. But it needs to go deeper. It needs to go with the understanding of what business we're about and what gifts we've been given to become involved in our own faith communities. Then we can prioritize. We can say, yes, that's for me, that's for my family, and I want to jump in with both feet and let it bring meaning into our lives.
Barbara DeGroat Sorensen is co-author of Escaping the Family Time Trap. DeGroat Sorensen says the choices we make at home have a lot to do with the busyness of our lives.
Some of the choices that we make actually become the trap. For instance, you can make financial choices on mortgages or credit card debt or possessions or things, financial decisions that trap you into a work schedule that then traps you as far as being able to spend that time with family. You know, if the debt is there, then the work has to happen in order to pay the debt. Families, if they're feeling a longing for something, that they need to pay attention to that. And just sit down and talk about, what are we longing for? Who do we want to be as a family? Where's the pinch? And actually define it and pinpoint it and name it. That's just a very good first step. Because that longing is placed there as a gift. And we need to pay attention to that. That's the God part, I think. God places this longing in our heart for wholeness and connectedness. And we just need to stop and pay attention to that. Worship is crucial to the busy family. Worship for a lot of people, and I know it was for myself in my most busy times, was the 1 hour a week I could sit down with my kids and put them on my lap. And that was, now when I look back on it, a real blessing, although at the time I remember telling myself, I'm just being faithful, I'm here, I'm getting nothing from this. But when I look back, I had 1 hour of quiet time, and sometimes it felt like that was the only hour I had all week. So worship is crucial to the busy family. You're together and you're focused on something together, which is bigger than yourself. I don't think families are looking for more things to do. They're looking for more connectedness. So as a church, I think we need to be asking the questions, what can we do to help families connect with each other and connect with their bigger family, which is the church, and then ultimately connect with the world or the globe, which, you know, is God's goal for us, I think. But that doesn't mean be there Wednesday night at 7:00.
One national organization that spends a lot of time addressing busy family life is the Youth and Family Institute at Augsburg College. David Anderson is director of faith formation and education.
In the psalm, it says, count your days that you may gain a heart of wisdom. I think we need to attend to the preciousness of time, the sense of Sabbath, the sense of holy rest and new beginnings, and just being in the presence of a gracious, loving God, that we don't have to always be busy. Now, I know I'm saying what I don't always do myself, but it's a goal. In the busy culture we live in, I want to slow down. I don't want to get caught up into the values and standards and the belief systems that say, David, you aren't valuable unless you've got 20 things on your plate today. I think it would be very helpful if we had a balance between some family nights in the congregation that equipped the home, and then some nights that we said, time out, we're not going to meet tonight. We're going to have this as a time for people to be in their own dwellings. Another thing, too, would be encourage families not to be overcommitted to congregational programming. One of the sad things is discover sometimes families feel like they're failures in the life of the church because they don't attend every activity. And yet they're doing wonderful things in their own homes, but they do not feel affirmed for the way they're nurturing the faith in the home. They feel like the only way they can be affirmed is to participate in another program in the congregation. We need some of those programs to do the equipping. We also need to back away from some of those programs to let people just be with one another in their own homes. I think what's essential to helping families in their busy lives is for them to know they're not alone. We need the support of one another, and a big part of that support is our congregational brothers and sisters. That means that we meet in homes together. That means sometimes we gather together in the life of the congregation, but we gather around essentials. Sometimes we find ourselves busy, not only in the home, but in congregations, doing the same old things that we've done for 20 years, because we've done it for 20 years. It seems like it must be right to do that. I think congregations have to do some rethinking as well. And if it's not nurturing faith, why bother at this time in our lives? We have so many other things going on. If congregations could slow their schedules down, to give families permission to slow their schedules down, one sphere of church might support the other sphere of the church.
Bob Seitz on the ELCA stewardship staff agrees with Anderson. Seitz is the author of Not Trying Too Hard, New Basics for Sustainable Congregations.
Program congregations, the size that many of our congregations are, tend to make families come apart because they make families busy. And so mom, dad, and the kids are running in different directions. The church, in those cases, is doing the same kind of things that the general society may be doing to congregation members. In fact, it's the more faithful people, the ones that we would call the active members or the involved people. These are the folks that are more down at church, more being torn apart as families, than the so-called inactive folk. And these are the people who are trying so hard to do the right things for their families by involving their children or themselves in the programs of the church, that they're the ones being pulled apart. It's almost a cruel irony how trying too hard sets up its own futility. I think the answer is for folks to look seriously at what kinds of things they're afraid of, what kinds of things they're worried about, what their anxieties are, what their angers are, what things frustrate them, the places in their life that they see things are futile, and for them to start to make hard choices about what's really important. Another part of the answer is for congregations to focus on things like conversation, relationships, non-programmed experiences, programs that take a minimum of people to run, that don't require long years of planning, that don't focus on ideas and ideals as much as they do relationships. I think it's important for congregations to start to measure their worth by how well the people know each other, by how well the people interact and connect to each other outside of church. I think it's good for congregations to take a hard look at what they're getting out of their programs versus what they're putting into them in terms of time and effort. I think it's worth congregations evaluating, and families evaluating even, which of our children's activities or our own activities give us or yield results that are beneficial for our children long term in all the things we hope for our children. And if the church comes up short, we need to admit that.
If I had to buy one book on men's ministry, this would be the book.
Doug Haugen is director for Lutheran Men in Mission, the men's ministry of the ELCA.
One of the things we've seen in our work with Lutheran Men in Mission, our work with men in the ELCA, is that the work week is actually increasing, and the demands of the workplace are actually increasing. At the same time, while men are telling us that it's their heart's desire to be the best possible family men that they can be, they want to be good grandfathers, they want to be good dads, they want to be good husbands. And at the same time, the boss is asking even more of them than ever before. The result is a lot of guys are really feeling stressed out. I know in the 1970s, I was hearing that my generation would be the first one to see a 30-hour work week. Well, the average work week is in excess of 50 hours, and there's now less leisure time for most people than there ever has been. We have to find some new ways of doing ministry in the congregation where our ministry fits our congregations and our people more than asking our people to fit our congregational schedules.
When we just moved from our other house, was right by a cemetery, and I'd walk around the cemetery every day, which was, at first was, I thought, was kind of depressing. But then you start to look for, what's the message here? And you read the tombstones, and it says, so-and-so, wife of, or husband of, son or daughter of. It doesn't say vice president of, or 30 years in. Those words you won't find, but you'll see the connections, you'll see the relationships. So when we finally end it all, we get it straight. And we put it on our tombstone for everybody to see.
If you'd like to learn more about family ministry in the ELCA, or more about the stories you've seen in this program, give us a call or log on to our website for transcripts and links to family ministry. Thanks for watching. This is Mosaic, the video magazine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, and you're part of it.